والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. لهم البشرى في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. لا تبديل لكلمات الله، ذلك هو الفوز العظيم. صدق الله العظيم. Honorable scholars, respected brothers and elders, we all know that the definition of iman is for a person to utter and proclaim the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is what enters a person in the fold of Islam and makes a person a Muslim. Believe in the oneness of Allah and the prophethood, or the finality of the prophethood of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, very strangely, or very differently rather, when we look for the definition of a believer in Quran and Hadith, there is a very different approach to defining who a believer is in Quran and Hadith. So the definition of a believer in Quran and Hadith is not just one who recites the kalima, or one who has faith in the prophethood of the various prophets, but rather a believer has been repeatedly introduced in Quran and Hadith through his noble qualities. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked who is the best believer, he said the one with best character. Ahsanuhum akhlaqa. Another hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described who is a believer. Al-muslimu man salima al-muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi. The one who does not harm any others with his tongue or with his hands. وَالْمُؤْمِنُ مَنْ أَمِنَهُ النَّاسُ عَلَىٰ دِمَائِهِمْ وَأَمْوَالِهِمْ. A believer is one who does not harm anyone. Everyone feels safe. This man will not harm me simply because he's a believer. Contrary, Allah forbid, the situation has reversed so tragically that if they have to choose anyone that will harm me, it's a Muslim. We need to ask ourselves, are we exhibiting the character of Islam in the correct manner or not? Why is this perception being created that if there is anyone? And the hadith says a believer is one when somebody sees him, if I am safe from anyone, it's this man because he's a Muslim. وَالْمُؤْمِنُ مَنْ أَمِنَهُ النَّاسُ عَلَىٰ دِمَائِهِمْ وَأَمْوَالِهِمْ. Then another hadith, the Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes a believer. المؤمنون هينون لينون كالجمل الآنف إن قيد إن قاد ومن أنيخ على صخرة استناخ. A believer is very soft, gentle, kind, accommodating and loving. Another hadith, the Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, المؤمن مألف. The believer is an abode of love and mercy. So who is a believer? He is an abode of love and mercy. ولا خير في من لا يألف ولا يؤلف. There is no goodness, and there can never be the perfection of iman in that believer who does not enjoy that quality of mercy. The point that I'm trying to drive home is, the believer has been described in Quran and Hadith through his qualities, through his traits, through his noble practices. What does this tell us? This is of such great importance in the life of a believer that it has actually assumed the position of his very definition. Noble qualities and pious traits in the life of a believer is of such importance that it has assumed the position of his very definition. One of the qualities of a believer, which we briefly touch on, the Master sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the obedience of Allah creates joy in your heart and the disobedience of Allah leaves you restless, that's a sign that you have iman in your heart. إِذَا سَرَّتْكَ حَسَنَتُكَ وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَتُكَ فَأَنْتَ مُؤْمِنٌ. The obedience of Allah gives you a thrill, it gives you a kick, it gives you joy, it gives you pleasure. And the disobedience of Allah leaves you with insomnia, it leaves you with a restless night. That's a sign of iman in your heart. There's a hadith in Bukhari Sharif, the Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى مَا يَمْحُ اللَّهُ بِهِ الْخَطَايَا. We are speaking about getting happy through the obedience of Allah. Qurbani is coming, the occasion of slaughtering on the name of Allah is coming. How much of a thrill is it giving me? How much of excitement and build up there is for this day? Should I not inform you of those deeds that will be a means of your forgiveness? And via which Allah will elevate your status. Sahaba said, please inform us all of you of Allah. The Prophet said, Isbaghu al-wudu'i ala al-makari. To perform wudu perfectly even under difficult conditions. وَكَثْرَةُ الْخُطَى إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ. Excessive footsteps to the masjid. وَإِنْتِظَارُ الصَّلَاةِ بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ. And to passionately wait for the arrival of the next salah after having performed one salah. Imagine that quality. You're passionately anticipating the arrival of the next salah. So you're constantly looking at your watch. Are you not too bad? Only 1 hour left for asr. For us, sure, it's Maghrib already. I didn't even realize that yet. You know, those that have a passion for sports, months in advance, they're waiting for that particular month. And then when that month comes, now it's that week and that build up and that aisle. Only to find out you lose against Japan. That whole build up for what? That passion, that excitement. That kick, that drive. Sahaba found that kick and that passion and that joy and that jubilation and that satisfaction when they obeyed Allah. And they expressed great sadness if they lost any opportunity in pleasing Allah. So Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu tells Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma that, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that person that follows a janazah, performs a janazah, he will get the reward of one qirat. One qirat is equivalent to Mount Uhud. And if he accompanies the janazah and is part of the burial procedure, then he will get the reward of two qirats. So Abdullah bin Umar went to Abu Hurairah, went to Aisha radiallahu anha to verify the hadith. She said, yes, I heard this from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Inna lillah, laqad dayya'na qiratan kathira. Wow, we really missed out on loads of reward. He expressed that inner grief that if I only knew this hadith, I could secure an additional avenue of pleasing Allah. So what was the sadness? I missed out on so much reward. What was the happiness? I obeyed Allah. That is why the scholars say, every day in your life that passes by in which you do not disobey Allah, that's an eid for a believer. Every day in which, why? Because that's what brings, eid is a day of happiness. Where's the happiness of a believer? I obeyed Allah, and by the grace of Allah, I abstain from his disobedience. I am thrilled. Not that it should create a sense of pride, but rather it should give inner satisfaction. And that is why, and this is divine from Allah, Allah will create that. The more we go towards Allah, Allah will create that. Look at the lives of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That amazing passion to secure the pleasure of Allah. You know how we look for an additional avenue of income? They look for additional avenues of good. What else can we do? In which way can I please my Allah? How can I get the happiness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about the sacrificing of the animal, the first question, Moolana fiha ya Rasulullah, Moolana fiha. Allah, let's talk, what are we going to get out of it? They're not talking of monetary gain. What's the reward? قَالَ بِكُلِّ شَعْرَةٍ حَسَنًا. For every hair you will get a reward. Sahaba's mind, Allah, for sufu ya Rasulullah, what about the wool? They said, قَالَ بِكُلِّ شَعْرَةٍ مِنَ السُّوفِ حَسَنًا. For every fiber of wool, you will get an independent reward. That was it. How can I get? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described the coming of Dajjal, and he said, "Yawmun kasana," one day will be like 1 year. The very first question that came to their minds in that one day: do we perform the salah of 1 day, or do we perform the salah of 1 year? The focus of the mind: how can I get an additional avenue through which I can please my Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that is what created joy in their heart. In Bayhaqi, there is a narration, the Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ نَظَرَ إِلَىٰ وَالِدَيْهِ نَظْرَ رَحْمَةٍ كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِكُلِّ نَظْرَةٍ حَجًّا مَبْرُورًا. That person that looks at his parents with a gaze of love, with a gaze of affection, with a gaze of mercy, in lieu of every gaze, Allah will give him the reward of an accepted Hajj. كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِكُلِّ نَظْرَةٍ حَجًّا مَبْرُورًا. The very first question, قَالُوا وَإِن نَظَرْنَا فِي يَوْمِ مِئَةَ مَرَّةٍ. Oh, Nabi of Allah, that seems tempting. What happens if we have to look at our parents with love 100 times a day? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Allahu Akbar wa Atiyab. There's no shortage in the reward of Allah. Allah will give you the reward of 100 Hajj. What was the response of Sahaba? إِذَن نَسْتَكْثِرْ. Oh, Nabi of Allah, you're really giving us a tempting offer. We'll go to town with it. The Quran describes the pain of the Sahaba that were unable to contribute and participate at the time of Tabuk. The last page of the 10th juz, the Jama'at of Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu anhu that came to the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. O Nabi of Allah, we passionately want to be part of the expedition and the campaign. If you could perhaps facilitate and provide and arrange for our transport. وَلَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ إِذَا مَا أَتَوْكَ لِتَحْمِلَهُمْ قُلْتَ لَا أَجِدُ مَا أَحْمِلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ تَوَلَّوْا وَأَعْيُنُهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْعِ حَزَنًا أَلَّا يَجِدُوا مَا يُنْفِقُونَ. Wow! Only if you could understand it direct from the language of the Quran. The Quran says there is no blame on those that intended to participate. When they came to you and they said, can you arrange a conveyance for us? And you said, لَا أَجِدُ مَا أَحْمِلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ. I do not have any conveyance to facilitate or provide for you. The regret and remorse of the Sahaba at that time, تَوَلَّوْا, they returned from your gathering. وَأَعْيُنُهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْعِ حَزَنًا أَلَّا يَجِدُوا مَا يُنْفِقُونَ. Crying profusely that they are unable to contribute to the cause of Allah. So what made them restless? I am unable to secure an additional avenue of pleasing Allah. It's not the fluctuation of the rand and the dollar or the volatility of the market that's leaving him restless. It's I am being deprived of an additional avenue of coming close to Allah. Under the commentary of this ayah, وَإِن قِيلَ لَكُمْ مُرْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا هُوَ أَزْكَى لَكُمْ. In Ma'arif al-Quran, it is written, Allah says that if you are to visit someone, and the response is, the person you are looking for is not here, could you please excuse yourself and come back later? The Quran says, do not feel it heavy on your heart. Return with a clean heart. This is a means of purifying your heart. So on this practice, the Quran says, what will Allah give you in return? Allah will give you a pure heart. It is written about one scholar who knocked on the doors of people with the hope that someone will reject him. And someone will say, I cannot see to you now, simply so that he can enjoy the virtue of being returned. And he said, by the grace of Allah, any ayah or any hadith in which the forgiveness of Allah has been promised, I endeavored to the best of my ability to implement it and to practice on it. With the acceptance of this one, I'm just looking for that opportunity when somebody returns me, so that I can enjoy that reward as well. The focus was the obedience of Allah. In Siyar wa A'lam in Nubala, there is a narration. A thief came by Malik bin Dinar. I don't think he was living in South Africa, but anyway, the narration says a thief came. فَلَمْ يَجِدْ شَيْئًا مِّن مَتَاعِ الدُّنْيَا. And he found nothing, no material wealth to steal or usurp. So Malik bin Dinar seen him and he said, you found nothing? تَرْغَبُ فِي شَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْآخِرَةِ. Can I make you a proposal and an offer? He said, what's your offer? He said, you came for dunya, come I give you akhirat. He said, come perform wudhuri 2 rakats of salah. Later when Malik narrated the incident, he said, he came to steal from us, we stole his heart. Nothing of akhirah. My deen, my Quran, my link, my bond with Allah. And for us, Allah forbid, because their passion is not there. You tell a man, read Surah Yaa, read Surah Mulk, Allah will protect you from the torment of the grave. Okay, mashallah, anything else? Tell him, read Surah Waqi, Allah will give you barakah in your sustenance. Even on his deathbed, he won't stop reading it. Why? The passion of dunya. We have understood the value of dunya. Sahaba understood the value of noble deeds. Al-malu wal-banuna zinatul hayati dunya. Wealth and sons is the beauty and adornment of this physical material life. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا. And the everlasting good deeds, that is better by your Lord. The Quran refers to good deeds as everlasting, simply because the reward of it is perpetual. So for a small deed, you get a great deal of reward. خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. Very briefly, I end on this note. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, sacrifice of his son Sayyidina Ismail, is the highest, the optimum level of sacrifice on the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One or two points that we understand this quality of becoming happy at the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Mufassirin say that Allah had revealed this instruction to Sayyidina Ibrahim in the form of a dream. Why did Allah not send the angel Jibra'il to convey the message and command of the slaughtering of the son? Allah is giving such a apparently challenging instruction and command, and Allah is sending it in the lightest form of revelation. So the command is so strict. It's something that's very strange, very difficult. And in our terms, a child is coming to give you the message and say, no, something wrong with the child. Ibrahim alayhi salam knew, my dream is from Allah. So Allah gave him the most challenging command in the lightest form of revelation. And he fulfilled it to the best of his ability. And then what does the Quran say? He called his son. And look at this dialogue, it's amazing. He said, oh my son, this is the instruction that has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fanfur madha tara. What's your take on it? The Quran says, Ismail had reached the age where the father was extremely fond of him. I read it again this morning and it made me tear again. And every time you read it, it will make you cry. He said the father was extremely fond of him at that time. The bond, the link, the connection between father and son is at its peak. It's at its optimum level. And then what happened? He said, Fandur my mother, my son, this is the instruction. What's your take on it? The father did not engage in a dialogue or discussion whether to see, will I fulfill it or not. His only intention was, I want to see what is the level of faith in the heart of my son Ismail. So it's not that if you say no, I will not do it. I want to see to what extent and what level has the faith of my son Ismail been developed. So he said, oh my son, this is the dream that I have seen. Fanbur madha tara, what's your take on it? He said, ya abati fa'al ma tukmar. Wow, what an answer. He said, oh my father, do as you have been instructed to do. The Mufassirin say, he did not say, oh my father, slaughter me or sacrifice me. He said, do as you have been instructed to do. If there is something that is greater than this, satajiduni insha'Allah min as-sabirin. Insha'Allah, by the aid and assistance of Allah, I will be from those that persevere. He didn't say, don't worry. Then give it to me, I'll see to it. Inshallah, on the name of Allah. And then, minas sabirin, it's not only me, many have sacrificed for the cause of Allah. And then came the crucial moment. I ask for your undivided attention. And the Quran says, falamma aslama wa tallahu lil jabin. Mufassirin say, the jawab, the answer of falamma is mahzoor. To explain to you that the words of any language cannot possibly encapsulate the scene that took place at that time. It's Father Ibrahim taking his son Ismail, who came with lots of hopes. And then وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينِ, he lays him down to his side. The narration of Abdullah bin Abbas says one side of the forehead was on the ground. And then the son makes his final request to his father. Allahu Akbar. He says, "O my father, ensure that your knife is sharp. It must not happen because of a blunt knife you delay in fulfilling the order of Allah. O my son, O my father, perhaps if you feel it appropriate, cover my eyes. It must not happen that when your eyes meet with my eyes, your fatherly love overpowers you and you delay in fulfilling the order of Allah. O my father, I have one more request. If you want to take my garment and give it to my mother, perhaps it will be a means of comfort and consolement to her. But do me a favor, make sure my blood does not spill on my garment. Even after my demise, I do not want to aggravate the pain of my mom." The father Ismail sees this, father Ibrahim sees this, is reduced to tears. The narration of Ruh al-Ma'ani says, he then addressed his son, full of tears in his eyes. He said, "Oh my son, what a wonderful assistant you've been to me in fulfilling the order of Allah. What a wonderful assistant you've been to me in fulfilling the order of Allah." And then he puts all his force and tries to slaughter his son. But by the demand and by the decree of Allah, Allah had prevented that knife from slaughtering. Allah sent Jibreel alayhi salam with an animal from Jannah. And that is the Qurbani that we practice and will continue to be practiced till the day of Qiyamah. May Allah give us the true spirit of Qurbani. May Allah make us from amongst those who the obedience of Allah brings joy to our heart. Every occasion of the obedience of Allah must create joy. Imagine the reward of miswak. If you use miswak before performing salah, the reward of your salah is enhanced 70 times. Let's at least go back with that message. That I will use the miswak 70 times more reward for my salah. If your boss must tell you, work in a particular way for one day, and you get the wage of 70 days or 70 months, who will not do it? The passion of reward, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give it to us. One way to achieve it is muhasaba. Daily sit for 3 minutes, introspect, reflect. I'm running this rat race, my life is going on. What am I doing for my hereafter? I believe in Allah, I believe in death, I believe in the life after death. I believe in Jannah. Reflect and ponder, sit for 3 minutes daily. It's not a long time. Just ponder, what am I doing for my akhirah? Am I doing more for my dunya? Or am I doing more for my akhirah? May Allah make us from amongst those who the obedience of Allah brings joy to their heart. And the disobedience of Allah creates restlessness in their heart. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.